Well, this morning we are going to begin a new series, Sitting at the Feet of Jesus. Now, there's somebody we all need to hear preach, right? There's somebody we all need to hear teach. And we have just finished the book of Revelation, and I still stand, and I am absolutely convinced more than ever that the book of Revelation is the most relevant book in our day and time. It speaks to us like no other book, and I believe we're living in cataclysmic times. I believe that we're going to see tumultuous things happen in our lives. And so, with elders, we were talking about this. He said, well, what should we do now? We've done Revelation, now what? And the now what is, how shall we live? That's what we want to talk about. We thought there was no one better to talk about. What shall we do in light of the times that we're living in than to look at some of the teachings of Jesus Christ? So I've entitled the message this morning, Do You Feel Lucky? Do You Feel Lucky? Father, I just thank you for each and every person here. And I just thank you for what you're going to do, I believe, in this series. We've seen who Jesus is. We've seen the exalted Jesus. We've seen that he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And now, I pray in light of that, we'll really take seriously what he says we should do in the times that we're living in. How shall we be kingdom living saints? And so I just ask that you would fill me from the soles of my feet to the crown of my head. I know that everyone that you brought here for a reason. And I pray that none of them miss it. I pray that you give us ears to hear and soft hearts to receive. And I just thank you for what you're going to be doing in these next several minutes. And I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Skip, can you play the video? You know, this world has seen its share of great teachers, great philosophers. But the problem is they all died and they remain dead. And you know what that tells me? It tells me that they were human. It tells me that they were fallible. It also tells me that they were flawed, just like us. 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ did come to this planet, planet Earth. And many would say perhaps that Jesus is the greatest teacher, the greatest philosopher to ever live. Yet he was crucified by the Romans, he died, and he was buried. And it seemed that he met the same fate as all the great philosophers and teachers such as Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. But you see, that was Friday. Then Sunday came, right? And on Sunday, Jesus' tomb was empty, and the disciples went from being men of cowards to great men of courage in 50 short days. And that's solely because they said, I saw him, I saw the resurrected Jesus Christ. And their lives are forever changed. And you know what? The world has never recovered from those 11 disciples and the Apostle Paul, who also saw Jesus Christ resurrected on the Damascus Road. Jesus Christ is truly unique. He stands different from everyone else. The resurrection proves it. Jesus is God in skin. And therefore, because he is God, for no other reason, we ought to take very, very seriously what he says. And this morning, I want to start looking at Jesus' most famous sermon. It's known as the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount, by the way, is, at least as far as we know, Jesus' longest teaching. It's really his commentary on the Old Testament. And Jesus tells us in the Sermon on the Mount that if you're truly a believer, if you're truly a kingdom person, then this is who you should be and this is how you should behave. So he's really going to, in a way, be giving us all of us a test. He said, if you're truly one of mine, if you're truly a child of God, if you're truly a kingdom person, then this is who you should be, and this is how you should live. Jesus starts out 2,000 years ago, he was on a mountain. In Matthew chapter 5, starting at verse 3, on that mount, 2,000 years ago, he said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, and they persecute you, and they say all kinds of evil things about you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for great is your reward in heaven. Now, you know, if you listen to the average preacher today, the average motivational speaker, the average, you know, positive new age guru, you wouldn't hear these kinds of words coming from them. You would hear something more like this. Blessed are those who see themselves as having unlimited potential, for they shall be self-actualized. Blessed are those who are positive, for they shall be able to charm others. Blessed are the strong, because they get what they want in the end. And blessed are the wealthy, because they can determine their own destiny. They can control their lives. These are the kinds of things that you would hear from the self-help people, from the motivational people, from the people who, you know, proclaim the power of positive thinking. What a contrast, though, between Jesus and these people. Especially, it's stunning when you consider the definition of the word blessed. Blessed actually in the Greek means happy. It means fortunate. It can even be translated lucky. And it's as if Jesus is saying in the Beatitudes, lucky are the losers. How fortunate, how happy are the wimpy, weak doormats who always get beat up by. I mean, I don't know about you, but it seems like Jesus is one French fry short of a happy meal. I mean, no, he sounds like he's nuts. He's going completely contrary to conventional wisdom. Now, let me ask you a serious question, though. I want you to think about all the people that you know. Think about your friends. Think about family members. Think about neighbors. Think about co-workers. How many of them, now seriously, how many of them are genuinely happy? How many of them can you say really exude a joy on a consistent basis? Several years ago, that great theologian Madonna, Skip, can you put up a picture? You know, Madonna stunned the world. She was being interviewed. And at one point in the interview, she was asked by the reporter, are you happy? And she gave a stunning answer. She said, no, I'm not happy. And she said, not only am I not happy, I don't know of anybody who is happy. Now, that's a very revealing statement, because this woman clearly knows a lot of people. She knows certainly a lot of stars, Hollywood stars. And she said, I don't know of any single one of them that is truly happy. George Gallup, not too long ago, ran a survey of polls. The survey, the subject matter was happiness. And here's what Gallup found. He found that only 19% of Americans classified themselves as truly happy. Now, here's what's even more fascinating. Here was Gallup's definition of happy or happiness. He said this: it's those people who on a consistent, notice that, consistent basis experience fulfillment, peace, and a sense of hope in their lives, end of quote. Now, based upon that definition, how happy are you really? Do you meet that definition of happiness? Now, here is the really intriguing part to me about that survey with Gallup. In Gallup, found that only 8% of Americans, listen to this now, only 8% of Americans were termed what he called deeply committed followers of Jesus Christ. He termed them high spiritual faith people. Gallup said of these people, he said, these people are a breed apart. They are more tolerant of people of diverse backgrounds. That's kind of interesting. They are more involved in charitable activities. They are more involved in practicing Christianity. They are absolutely committed to prayer. And they are far, far happier than the rest of the population. End of quote. Do you know what Jesus says is our main problem? Do you know what the Beatitudes say our main problem is? They say that our main problem here and in America and in the world, that our biggest problem is most of us do not have the capacity to truly harness happiness and joy. Our greatest problem, or certainly one of our most biggest problems, is you and I simply do not have the capacity to harness happiness, to really harness joy. So what Jesus actually does in the Beatitudes is he gives us a formula. And we Americans just love formulas. He's going to give us a formula on how to be happy. Actually, he's going to give us a formula on how we can have the capacity to really experience happiness and joy in our lives. And you say, well, why does that matter? I'll tell you why it's going to matter. Because I'm going to tell you that you're going to have difficulty in your life. If someone tells you that it's going to be smooth and easy, they haven't lived very long, or they got their head in the sand, I can guarantee you that if you live long enough, you will experience suffering. And if you're anywhere watching what's happening in the news, you can count on trials and tribulations coming in your life. And the reason why joy, having happiness, is important is it gives you the power and the energy not to be defeated. It gives you the power and the energy to overcome and live a victorious life. And I don't think there's a person here. Aren't you tired? I think if you're depressed and you're down, you don't have the energy nor the strength to be victorious. But when you're experiencing that joy and that happiness, then you have tremendous power to overcome, not be defeated, and be a vibrant witness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in the remaining moments we have, let's look at the first beatitude. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3 this. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, the picture that Jesus is painting here is that of a beggar who has hit rock bottom. Skip, can you put up the picture? Now, picture yourself. You come walking up to this guy. All right? There he is. And he says to you, you know, I'm really not as beggarly as all the other beggars that you see. I actually, you know, at one time graduated from high school. You know, I had a job. I had some money in the bank. You know, I'm just not as beggarly. I'm not as bad as all of these other beggars. How would you respond to that? I mean, it would almost be laughable, wouldn't it, that this guy would try to portray himself as something other than what he really is. He's a poor, he's a needy beggar. And do you realize what Jesus, though, is saying to each and every one of us in here? Jesus is saying to each and every single one of us, you and you and you and you and me, we are all poor, needy beggars. You know, and I'll tell you, that just really sticks in the craw of many of us. You know, we have difficulty with it. You know, we like to think that we are something. We delude ourselves into thinking that we're something. You know what the reality is, though? The reality is that we are all nothing. The good news is that God can take nothing and create something. That is what the good news is. But we don't like the idea that I am needy, that I am helpless, and that I am not self-sufficient. I don't know if you remember when you were a kid. I do. You remember when you were trying to tie your shoelaces? Remember that? I do. I remember one day I was trying in the morning to tie my shoelaces, and I was having difficulty, and my mother came up to me and said, "Do you want some help?" And here's little Frankie's response. Little Frankie's response was, "I do it myself." And my mom said, she's Italian, said, "Go ahead, knock yourself out." She came back 15 minutes later, and my shoelaces were all in knots. And you know, that's kind of the same attitude that we all just carry in this life into adulthood, don't we? We just say, "I do it myself," and we wonder why. No, seriously, we wonder why our relationships, we wonder why our lives are in such knots, because we say, "I do it myself." The truth is, though, is we're not near as self-sufficient as we think we are. In fact, in the New Testament book of Colossians, the Apostle Paul wrote these words. He said this, "Jesus is not only before all things, but he is the one holding all things together." That is an incredible statement. What that is saying is that Jesus is the author of life. He literally holds this universe together. He is what holds us together, whether you recognize it or I recognize it or not. We all need Jesus Christ. He is the one who gives life, and we need his life. But I'll tell you, we don't like that. We don't like the fact, especially as Americans, we're so independent, and we don't like the idea that we have to admit we are needy. We need someone or we can't make it. We love to hide behind the mask of self-sufficiency, don't we? We like people to think we have it all together, when the reality is we don't have it all together. And my question is this, you know, as I was thinking about this, we feel the need to try to fool people into thinking we have it all together? Why is it? And the answer really is, at least the short answer, we learned it from our parents. The parents being Adam and Eve. Do you remember way back in the book of Genesis when Adam first met Eve? Do you remember that? You know, first of all, Adam had seen a parade of animals. He had seen, you know, rhinoceroses, he had seen hippos, you know, he had seen duck-billed platypuses, he had seen all of these animals. And they were coming in waves of two. Each of them had dates. Adam now noticed he didn't have a date, that he was alone. And so God puts Adam asleep. And when Adam wakes up, what does he wake up to? Does he wake up to a four-footed, you know, woolly, furry mammal? No, he wakes up to a ravishing, beautiful female. And as the joke goes, Adam cries out, "Woa, man," from which we get woman. So you're probably wondering why that happened. That's how that happened. And it says in Genesis, now watch this. It says in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 25, now I want you to watch. "The man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame." Now, why does the Bible say this? And I don't think it's because Adam and Eve were, you know, working out all the time and they had a low percentage of body fat. I don't think that's why it says that. No, I really thought about it. Why does it say that they were naked and they felt absolutely no shame? I'll tell you why. It's because there was no hiddenness. They had no secrets. No secrets between themselves. No secrets from God. No secrets, by the way, that separate. And they were extremely emotionally and psychologically healthy. Now, we all know the rest of the story. What happened? Adam and Eve chose to sin. And what's the first thing they did? What's the first thing that Adam and Eve did after they sinned? They hid it. They first hid from God, and then they hid from one another by wearing lousy clothes. Right? I mean, that's what they did. They hid from each other. And you know what? You and I, in humanity, in hiding ever since. Now, let me challenge us this morning. Jesus says, listen to me now, the first step, if you really want to create the capacity to be happy, to experience joy, you have to be sound of mind and have healthy emotions. You know why most people, quite honestly, in America, really, my mind was psychology, my mother was a secular psychologist, and I'll tell you what, most people are profoundly screwed up in the mind. No. They are rich. And you know who are the sickest people? Christians. It doesn't bother me. No, it does not bother me that people come in here and they are sick. That doesn't bother me. What bothers me is that they stay sick. That's what's tragic. It's tragic that a person comes in here, they recognize they are sick, and they really never, ever change. They never somehow come to a point where they meet Jesus Christ in such a way that they become healthy in their minds. They become healthy in their emotions. That, to me, is an absolute tragedy that is happening, literally, in the American church. And the reason why for this is because most of us remain hidden. We have these secrets, and it absolutely kills us. You know, one of AA's cardinal doctrines is, listen to this now, is I am as sick as my secrets. I am as sick as my secrets. A counselor in AA once said this, I know many folks with dark secrets and nowhere to take them. Sometimes they go crazy, literally insane, because they can't stand being alone with their dark thoughts and secrets. Or they get loaded, or they get high. The counselor went on to talk about this pastor who had a successful street ministry. No, I mean, it was a rather large ministry. But this pastor himself, interestingly enough, he's dealing with all of these street people, these people who are sick, these people who are hurting. But he himself was struggling with failures. He himself had these dark thoughts. And he kept them all bottled up. He had no place that he felt like he could go. And the counselor said one day, his wife came walking through the front door, and she saw his body swaying from a rope. How sad. How tragic. You know, James, the half-brother of Jesus, says this in chapter 5 and verse 16. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. There is no healing in hiding. You know, we may knock the Catholics once in a while because of confession. But you know what? They got something right. No matter what you think, they got something right. There is something very right. There is something very healing. When you can go to somebody, you can pour out your heart. And then someone prays with you. We may knock the confessional booth, and we may say, hey, you know what? I don't have to go to any priest to confess. Well, that may be true. I would agree with you that you can go to any person and confess. But it's not enough to say that I've confessed it to God. There's something necessary within each one of us that we not only need to confess it to God, and yes, He can forgive you, but there's something about it when I am struggling with something, you're struggling with something, and we're all struggling with something, and you can go to someone, and you can confess that to someone, or you can confess it to a group of people, and they lay hands on you, and they begin to pray for you. It says that there's real healing that occurs, and that is sadly lacking in the American church. The American church is like this. You will get up, and you will go out, and you will go out with your secrets. And you and I, as a consequence, and sadly and tragically, will remain sick. I want to close this morning with the quiz. Here's the quiz. How honest are you with God? How honest are you with God? Do you try to hide from Him by not telling Him what you are thinking and feeling and struggling with? When the Holy Spirit convicts you of something you did, do you try to rationalize, justify, and defend yourself? Do you regularly ask the Holy Spirit to search your heart, to bring to light what's lurking in the dark recesses of your heart? How honest are you with yourself? Do you try to convince yourself that you are all right, you are okay, and you don't need anyone else's help? You know, Jesus Christ said in John 15:5, "You can do nothing without me." Do you see yourself as really needing Jesus? Do you see yourself as really needing Jesus to achieve forgiveness, healing, fulfillment, and purpose and hope? How honest are you with others? Do you sometimes seek to create a better impression of yourself than is really the case? Do you sometimes leave others with the impression that you are spiritually mature and more committed than is actually true in your life? Are you covering up sins right now? Are you covering up sins right now rather than dealing with them in a biblical way? Do you see yourself, and are you putting up walls to keep yourself at an arm's distance from people so they can't really get to know the real you? Do you have at least one person that you've invited into your life, that you meet with regularly, that they have the right to examine your life, they can ask you any question that they want, you will answer truthfully, and they can speak into your life? Have you given anyone, just one person, that right? I suggest if you don't have that, then you're remaining in darkness. And this is really the first step. By the way, this is the first step of really living a vibrant Christian life. Some people pan me because I'm too transparent. They say, "Frank, you know, it's so obvious your problems." They say, "You've admitted depression, you've admitted everybody knows I have a hair trigger, anger, and this and that." And they go, "Wow, that's horrible." Well, no, the reason why I do it is because there's healing in confession. You're wrong. There's healing in confession. And you can hold me accountable to it. I know some people that will not put on their back of their car, no, seriously, they won't put on the back of their car, you know, a little fish symbol because they don't want people to know they're a Christian because they drive so crummy. No, they won't. I say put it on there for no other reason than so that you'll be held accountable. So someone can go to you, "Man, you drive like a jerk and you're a Christian." That will bring a little humility to your life and my life. No, I'm deadly serious. The reason why we're not winning out, and it bothers me that Islam is destroying us. I'll tell you why Islam is destroying us. Because they're more honest than we are. They really believe jihad's the way to go. I'm reading this book. It blows my mind. But they're deadly serious. And you see, we're supposed to show them a different way. We're supposed to be the ones that are full of love, full of joy, full of peace. Well, let me tell you something. If you're full of dark secrets, not full of dark secrets, there's no way you're going to be full of love and full of joy and full of peace. There's no way we're going to be impacting this world for Jesus Christ. This first step, I'm going to tell you, is absolutely essential. You know, you can wave it off. That's a tragedy. That'll be a tragedy. Because you know what? Jesus said, "If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed." And Jesus wants every single one of us free. Free. I'll tell you, there's nothing like it when you're free and the Holy Spirit is flowing through you. The only thing that I ask for every day is, "Oh God, whatever in darkness, bring it into light." Not so that I'm condemned. I want to be free. I want to experience the overflow of the Holy Spirit in my life. I know people have knocked before that, and that's fine. But I'm telling you that it's when you feel and experience experience the Spirit of God's love, then you're alive. Then you are truly alive, and it starts right there. You cannot be hiding in darkness. You cannot have secrets. It just will not happen. Jesus said, Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who recognize their needs. Blessed are those who are no longer hiding in darkness. And then you shall experience the kingdom. Father, pray for each and every single one of us here. I know you're speaking to us all because all of us have closets. And we allow you into certain rooms. But then there's rooms we won't let you in. And we say, not in here. And for every room that we don't let you in is a room where there's deadness and no light. And we kid ourselves if we think that deadness doesn't begin to impact the other areas of our lives. We kid ourselves if we think that deadness and that darkness doesn't affect our relationships. We wonder why we don't experience you and your presence in our lives. And so I pray and I ask this morning that more and more people would break the chains through the power of the Holy Spirit. That fear would be broken in this congregation. Fear of man, fear of what people think, fear of this world. And we'd only begin to fear sin and darkness and you. Then we would begin to find life. And we'd begin to be those vital witnesses. I ask for this in your precious name.